Which isn't necessarily a bad thing, it's just forgettable. It honestly kind of feels like a washer and dryer. It's like their marketing of their smartphones is right along the same lines as the marketing of their other appliances. But the crazy thing is, the actual character of LG phones over these years, really interesting and super low-key influential. So, over the past 8 years or so, I'd say, LG has been one of the few companies that actually tries very new things. Like, super wild things. Out of anything, really. But that's been their sort of motto, is just throwing a bunch of stuff at the wall and seeing what'll stick. And sometimes, it really did stick. Look at this list. In March 2007, we had LG Prada. That was the first capacitive touchscreen smartphone. Pretty much every smartphone today has a capacitive touchscreen. In 2010, LG Optimus 2X came out. That was the first dual-core processor smartphone ever, and the first to do 1080p video recording. Then the next year, LG Optimus 3D was the first phone with more than one rear camera. Think about that. When's the last time you saw a flagship with only one rear camera? They also had the first quad-core phone, the LG Optimus 4X. Then it gets serious. In September 2013, LG G2 is the first phone to have double tap to wake. At the time, they just called it the knock-knock feature. That the first mass-produced QHD display in a phone. That was the LG G3. Then the V10 would technically be the first dual-screen phone, thanks to the second screen embedded up top. Maybe that's a stretch, but there are some dual-screen phones out now. But then the LG G5 was the first phone with an ultra-wide camera on the back. Then the G6 was the first with an 18:9 display, having a little bit of that taller aspect ratio to keep it narrower and fit better in the hand. And then the V40 was the first phone with all three focal lengths on the back cameras. One ultra-wide, one standard, and one telephoto. So it would be pretty easy to miss if you weren't paying attention. But it turns out LG has been important as far as introducing new ideas that hooked and sort of got taken for granted today. I don't know if you can even buy that many smartphones at the high end that don't have an ultra-wide and tap-to-wake and a high-resolution display. These are all really good things that caught on that we see everywhere because they turned out to be good ideas. But there were also plenty of things that didn't catch on. Like that mini display on the top of the V10 and V20, we don't really see that anymore. The self-healing back on the back of the G Flex, really cool idea. You don't really see that anymore either. They tried curved phones for a while too because they were supposed to be more natural to holding your hand and up against your face. That didn't last long. They also had that one modular phone that 1 year with the G5. It was super cool, but a year later, they were done making modules for it, and the whole ecosystem folded. And then the G8 is the most memorable recent one for me. So that had an IR sensor array for reading the veins in your hand, and these weird gestures that barely worked. When these things didn't catch on, the next year, they were gone. They just dropped it. It was just gone from the next phone. And that makes sense, but it's also kind of unnerving as a customer. Like, what we look for in a long-term commitment to a phone is stability and reliability and consistency, and at least being somewhat predictable that these things will be useful for a long time. And so it's not likely you want to buy into an ecosystem of modules if you don't even know it'll be around the next year, you know? And that's not even considering LG's pretty bad track record of actually delivering software updates to their phones, which just adds into the whole not very predictable stability thing. Now, there's a lot of talk, I've noticed, about how maybe YouTubers are responsible for LG's downfall because we didn't give them enough credit.